One, for those brave souls who are sitting here instead of having a good time outside, my name is Uzi Rubin, and I'll be your chairman for this session, which is about a somewhat cryptic title, Mediterranean architecture. Whenever I hear the word architecture, when it's not about building, it probably means something about the future, future prospects. And this, of course, brings to mind the eternal saying of Yogi Berra that it's always difficult to make predictions, especially about the future. So our session will include four distinguished speakers, which I'll introduce one by one, not everyone separately, not ahead, but at the time. And there's two ways to make introduction. We learned in the morning session that when you do the full honors and you read the whole bio and you respect your speaker, you take his time and he resents you. So there's a short way, which I learned, which says something. This is John Smith. Everybody knows him. Speak. So I'll try to chart a mid-course and picking things from your bios at the risk of murdering your assassinating your character or something if I pick the wrong thing. So you are invited, after if you are unsatisfied by my introduction, to shoot me, but please do it outside after the session ends. I'll be waiting for you outside there. So our first speaker is Mr. Emmanuel Cohen Hadria. He's a graduate of Sciences Po in Paris, really the nursery of brain power in Europe for civil service and academia. I had the privilege of speaking there once, and I was quite impressed. Today is in the European Institute of Mediterranean since September 2015. He spent 8 years in European institution and coordinated the activities of the Euro-Mediterranean network of think tanks, which the acronym is Euro-MESCO. Did I say it correctly?
Correct.
Right. Great. So you can speak sitting, standing, with top head tie, without tie. This is Israel. Feel comfortable. Go ahead.
Hello. Good. Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to start by thanking the organizers very much for the invitation for this event. Maybe a bit less for the topic, because European perspectives on the Mediterranean architectures. This is indeed very very cryptic. You know, on the one hand, as a think tanker, I need to go through the factors that constrain, that limit the European clout, the European foreign policy clout in the Mediterranean. But on the other hand, and that's why I say it was not a very easy topic, on the other hand, I do not want to give bullets. I do not want to give fuel to a discourse here in Israel that is sometimes indeed a bit turning towards the EU bashing discourse. So I'll need to a bit strike the balance between these two constraints in my presentation. So as I said, let me maybe start by going through the factors that limit the potential of the European Union in the Mediterranean. And I'll start with a very obvious one, which is the electoral cycle. Next year, there will be European elections, so that means a new team at the European Commission, a new team at the European Parliament, a new team in terms of EU foreign policy. By the way, maybe a good window of opportunity for EU-Israel relationships. But that electoral cycle means that the current time is not conducive to grand ideas or very advanced initiatives when it comes to EU's engagement in the Mediterranean. So that was my first point. Second, and that was already discussed in a number of panels here, the migration and the refugee factor. That migration concern is indeed completely overwhelming. It absorbs most of the energy of the European Union when it comes to the Mediterranean, to the detriment of other maybe other tracks. If you observe a bit the EU agenda when it comes to the Mediterranean, if you scrutinize what the EU has been doing over the last years, you see that it very much follows somehow the migration routes. Remember 2015, a very strong concern regarding the eastern Mediterranean routes. Well, the EU responded with a very engaging EU-Turkey deal that was, as you know, criticized for a number of reasons. A lot of resources, a lot of energy in this deal. Now, as you may know, Spain is again the first receiving country from the Mediterranean European countries. So that has translated it into a renewed package from the European Union to Morocco. That will translate into a French-sponsored EU-Med summit that is expected to take place next year on the 24th of June, and that will be mostly focusing on the Western Mediterranean in a format that is a bit weird. It's more or less the 5+5 from the Western Mediterranean plus Germany. My third point in terms of, again, those factors that limit the potential of the EU is that maybe, well, to some extent, the EU foreign policy toolbox is not adapted to the sort of architecture that is taking shape in the Mediterranean. The EU foreign policy toolbox arguably is not suited to situations where hard security prevails, where multilateralism is being weakened. There was an attempt to adjust a bit this toolbox back in 2015. You know, the main policy framework of the European Union when it comes to the neighborhoods is the European Neighborhood Policy. Well, back in 2015, there was the attempt to revise this, to make the EU's offer a bit less conditional, to be more pragmatic. Well, we need to wait maybe a bit, but this until now has not really translated into very tangible results. The EU, if you look at its the parameters of its engagement, is very much in the business of supporting regional organizations. Some of you will know the Union for the Mediterranean Union. The Secretariat General of that organization is based in Barcelona. The EU, by the way, backs more than half of the budget of that organization. But the UFM is not fully equipped to deal with some of the hard issues and hard challenges of the region. The EU continues to also put its money on some regional organizations or some sub-regional organizations. The Arab League is one of them. By the way, if you're interested, I would invite you to follow the summit, so at the heads of state level, between the Arab League and the European Union that will be taking place in February under Saudi chairmanship and hosted by Egypt. So quite interesting to watch. The problem with the Arab League is that it is, completely divided, dysfunctional. There was maybe for the Arab League a bit of a window of opportunity after the Arab Spring. You remember that the Arab League took very strong stances on Libya, lending legitimacy to the Western intervention. Was quite straightforward with Syria. But again, now the Arab League has got back to its normal course. Fourth constraining factor, the divisions within the European Union among the member states, not only, by the way, when it comes to EU foreign policy, but also when it comes to the European Union project or how this European project should be organized. There are, as you know, tensions between the European Commission with Hungary, with Poland, with Italy on different files. So if the EU architecture is a bit shaky, is a bit under pressure, it makes the potential, the chances of the European Union to engage on the architecture of another region even more difficult. The fifth challenge, obviously, is the increasingly hostile discourse from some of the partners of the European Union. You take Turkey, you take the US, you take Russia, Israel to some extent. There is a growing hostile discourse towards the European Union. But then, so with all these limitations, my point here is that there are also reasons to that make me think that this a very dark assessment is not fully justified when it comes to EU's engagement in the region. First, you will argue, and that's probably true, that the EU doesn't have really the means to take sides in an architecture in a region characterized by very strong alliances, camps that are really taking roots. The EU maybe doesn't have the means to take sides, but on the other hand, I think the EU is also tempted to think that it is also in its interest not to take sides. Maybe the EU is lucky enough to afford this. Israel is maybe not able to do so, but the EU maybe is quite happy of the fact it doesn't have to take really a strong position in this. By the way, it's not alone in this game. To some extent, China is also not really engaging in terms of taking sides in that alliances game. Second, I think the EU is also quite consistent in its approach in the sense that it continues to think that the underlying reasons that led to the events of 2011 with the Arab Spring have not been addressed. It continues to think that security cannot be isolated from socio-economic development. I think that the to some extent these days, when I was hearing about the Israelis' efforts in terms of promoting socio-economic development of East Jerusalem, of the West Bank, of Gaza, to some extent, and all things equals, par ailleurs, you could argue that the EU's arguments in terms of promoting socio-economic development for the whole Arab region is also obeying to the same sort of rationale. Third, and I'm already almost there, but third point, EU is not yet out of the radar. I know that there was a survey conducted here by an Israeli think tank recently on the EU's perception in Israel. We at the IMED, at the European Institute of the Mediterranean in Barcelona, we conducted a survey recently for the whole Euro-Mediterranean region. We will publish this soon. Our findings that the EU continues to be considered as an attractive partner, continues to be seen as a foreign policy priority partner by the community of experts in the Euromed business. So it also shows that the EU continues to be considered as a force for good. Of course, some of the things it does, some of the things it stands for, may provide some instability for the South Med region, but overall, it is not considered in this survey as a major source of instability in the region, unlike other players such as the US or the GCC, again, according to this survey results. Fifth, and I only have 6 points, but fifth point is that some of the member states of the EU, and that we had plenty of opportunities to discuss this, some of the Eastern Mediterranean countries, member states of the European Union, have a very important role to play, in particular in this trilateral between Israel, Cyprus, and Greece. And this is something to the full benefit of the European Union. If you read that European Neighborhood Policy Review of 2015, you find a sentence that reads that the EU is very much willing to encourage the sub-regional integration, including in the Eastern Mediterranean. And you know, if you take the Eastern Mediterranean pipeline, the European Commission has also showed, maybe that will be discussed later on, has also shown a very great deal of support for this initiative. And to finish, my last point is that whatever you think of it, the EU continues to be a predictable partner that champions multilateralism with all the things that will be said on the nuclear agreement here, part of the rationale of the European Union, I guess, with this agreement is that it is related to its commitment to multilateral diplomacy. As it was said here in previous panels, it thinks that the breakout capacity of the Iran has been drastically reduced with that deal. It thinks also that engaging, that this deal also maybe opens some channels of communication with Iran that are interesting to explore also for the benefit of the stability in the region. So I'll stop it here. Just in conclusion, for those of you that are interested in the Euromed relations, things to watch in the coming weeks or months. There will be a ministerial between Egypt and the EU very soon, in about 10 days. There will be this EU-Arab League summit in February. There will be an important conference on Syria in spring, in April, I think, in Brussels. And then there will be this this French-sponsored Euromed summit. I think they're still busy in trying to find a name for this summit on the 24th of June in Marseille. Thank you very much for your attention. And again, thank you for the organizers and to the whole teams.
Thank you for the fascinating survey of the European Union. Let me say that as a bystander from the side, I see the EU problem as such in the terms that the EU is a union based on values.